never to rise, snuffed out, quenched like a wick.
But that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God.
If they were serious about the sin of adultery, why didn't they bring the man with her? Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of God our Father, the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, the companionship of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Good morning. We find ourselves well on our way to the most sacred time of the year on this fifth Sunday of Lent. As you know, in the Holy Year, the theme is mercy and forgiveness, and we couldn't have a better example of that than of the Gospel today in which the woman caught in adultery is condemned to die. And Jesus enters upon that scene. We all know the story. A wonderful example of what we mean by mercy and forgiveness. Let's pause a moment as we begin. Lord Jesus, you've shown us by your own life and example what it means to be a merciful people. Christ Jesus, you invite us to join you on the journey to Jerusalem and to Calvary. Lord, in acknowledging our own need for forgiveness, may we be a people of forgiveness toward others. We pray to the Lord. By your help, we beseech you, Lord our God, may we walk eagerly in that same charity with which, out of love for the world, your Son handed himself over to death. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Now we invite all of our young people here for their own study of God's Word. Wait. I'm glad you're eager, but you're too eager. Okay. All right. Got everybody? Oh, some more yet. Good. There's a little one with their big brother. Okay. God, Heavenly Father, we rejoice that these young people may, along with us, listen to your word of hope, forgiveness, and love. May they allow that word to enter their hearts as we do the same here in church. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, thank you.
A proclamation from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, who opens a way in the sea and a path in the mighty waters, who leads out chariots and horsemen, a powerful army, till they lie prostrate together, never to rise, snuffed out, quenched, like a wick. Remember not the events of the past, the things of long ago consider not. See, I am doing something new. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? In the desert I make a way, in the wasteland rivers. Wild beasts honor me, jackals and ostriches. For I put water in the desert and rivers in the wasteland for my chosen people to drink, the people whom I formed for myself, that they might announce my praise. The word of the Lord.
Proclamation from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, I consider everything I was as a loss. Because of the supreme good of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for his sake, I have accepted the loss of all things, and I consider them so much rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having any righteousness of my own based on the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God, depending on faith to know him and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by being conformed to his death. If somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead, it is not that I have already taken hold of it, or have already attained perfect maturity, but I continue my pursuit in hope that I may possess it, since I indeed have been taken possession of by Christ Jesus. Brothers and sisters, I, for my part, do not consider myself to have taken possession. Just one thing, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I continue my pursuit toward the goal, the prize of God's upward calling, eternal life in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, but early in the morning he arrived again at the temple area, and all the people started coming to him, and he sat down and taught them. Then the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery and made her stand in the middle. They said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the very act of committing adultery. Now, in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such a woman. What do you have to say?" They said this to test him so that they could have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and began to write on the ground with his finger. But when they continued asking him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let the one among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." Again, he bent down and wrote on the ground. And in response, they went away, one by one, beginning with the elders. So he was left alone with the woman before him. Then Jesus straightened up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She replied, "No one, sir." Then Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, do not sin anymore." The Gospel of the Lord. This incident took place in the temple area, in the large courtyard, the first courtyard that you enter. So, but anybody can go in there, Jew or Gentile. It's just they can't. Others may not go beyond that if they're not Jewish believers. And so, this whole thing was set up to embarrass Jesus. If they were serious about the sin of adultery, why didn't they bring the man with her? So you can see right from the outset, they were not really all that serious about the sin of adultery, but much more so about trapping Jesus and embarrassing him. And so it was that they did that. Our Lord had encountered situations like this before. It's a typical dilemma. If he would say, no, it's wrong to do, they'd say, what kind of a Jewish teacher are you? You know the law. It says she should be condemned. On the other hand, if he said, go ahead and stone her to death, they would say, well, what kind of a compassionate Jewish teacher are you? So either way, they would have gotten at him. But our Lord, very quietly listening to them, writing on the ground, and that's intriguing. We don't know what he really wrote, but many will say he was writing down the sins of these very men who were standing there. But in any case, he straightened up and he said very simply to them, okay, go ahead, but let us begin with the eldest among you, and any of you who yourselves have not sinned, go ahead and stone her. They were astounded. They didn't expect that. It was embarrassing because he said, begin with the elders. And it doesn't say this in the scriptures, but you can use your imagination and listen to those stones as they're being dropped on the pavement in that courtyard. And as they slowly began to slink away until he was left with the woman and he forgave her. Very powerful. And I say it's a perfect image or example of forgiveness in this year of mercy and forgiveness. What better one could we have than the gospel that we have today? Now, that was more than 2,000 years ago. And I'd like us to flash forward to today, to this year. In fact, to February 11th of this year. There was an article in the paper that caught my attention. It's a picture of a black youth lying face down on snowy pavement. No jacket, no jeans, just in his underwear, lying on that snowy pavement. And I'd like to quote a little bit from the article. It says, car theft suspect beaten and stripped. Photos of a teen boy lying beaten and partially clothed on a Milwaukee sidewalk are generating intense reaction on the social media this week, with some outraged at the violence and others saying the boy got what he deserved. It's a backstory that has people fired up. That boy was suspected of trying to steal a car on the city's south side, and he was beaten and stripped of his pants after the victim caught him in the act. Photos of the boy then were posted on Facebook and shared widely. He was punched and then knocked down, and as the suspect tried to climb a fence to get away, another witness caught him by the pants and pulling them off. The car theft suspect was identified by police as a 15-year-old Milwaukee boy who suffered a minor injury in the incident and had been arrested. The police also said in their statement on the incident that they plan to recommend charges against the person who was responsible for beating the boy and posting the photos on Facebook. It shows the boy sprawled out in the snow in what appears to have been only a shirt, underwear, and socks. His post had been shared more than 300 times on Wednesday Greenwich Times as of Wednesday morning. The reaction on Facebook to the incident and the photo had been deeply divided. Someone said, "Now there's a happy end. Only way it could be better if the whole crew were beaten senseless." But some of the people responding to the post have questioned the extreme measures taken against the suspected thief. Quote, "This is inhumane, no matter the accusations. He's still a kid, is still capable of turning his life around with some guidance, not dehumanizing him." So I ask myself the question, and I ask you the question, what would you have done in those circumstances? People very angry at what's going on in our city and finally having someone caught in the act of doing it. What would have been our reaction? Would have been of one of anger, thrusting out at him, striking him, or would have been one of mercy and forgiveness? The only other question I would ask is, what if our Lord had been there, as he had in the incident in today's gospel? We know what he would have done. He would have said the very same thing. "Let those among you who can say that they are free of any sin be the first one to strike him." And I think we can draw some conclusions from that. The only other thing I remember is that as a very young person, maybe in grade school, someone one time said that when we point our finger at someone in accusation, we're really pointing three fingers at ourselves. Would be another way of looking at this incident.
Please join us now in the Apostles' Creed on page 9. "I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and descended into hell. On the third day,
continue our Lenten journey, approaching very soon the most sacred time of the year. We come, as always, with needs our own and those of so many others.
Our response will be, "Lord, let us be like you." For the world, may we believe in the forgiveness of sins and the power of loving sacrifice. We pray,
Lord, let us be like you.
For Pope Francis, may we follow his leadership as he calls all people together to work for peace and justice, love and mercy, following the way of Jesus. We pray,
Lord, let us be like you.
For families, for married couples, that they may grow together in faithfulness. For children, that they may know they are loved and cherished. For those who have made mistakes and are hoping for another chance, we pray,
Lord, let us be like you.
For those with whom we disagree, for those whose habits are irritating to us, for those we struggle to love, we pray,
Lord, let us be like you.
for those we have disturbed by our behavior or our words, for those we may have confused or scandalized, for those who struggle to love us. We pray,
Lord, let us be like you.
For our youth preparing for confirmation, and for Nicole Corey, may they know that we, their St. James family, will continue to support them in their journey to the Easter Vigil and beyond. We pray,
Lord, let us be like you.
For those signed in our Book of Life, and for our deceased brothers and sisters, especially Vincent Bickler and Michael Town, for whom this Eucharist is offered, we pray,
Lord, let us be like you.
God, Heavenly Father, during this holy season of Lent, help us to become ever mindful of the many sins and offenses that we have committed and the many times that you have graciously forgiven us. May we do so as well for one another, following the example of Jesus, your Son. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our presentation song is Servant Song, found on page 28.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received this wine we offer you, fruit of the vine, work of human hands, it will become for us our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God.
Spirit contrite, may we accept and learn our sacrifice and sight, pleasing to you. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our offering, our Lenten offering this morning, may be acceptable to to God the Father Almighty.
Lord, accept the sacrifice of our hands for the praise of the Lord God Savior, for our good and of all God's holy church.
Hear us, Almighty God, and having instilled in your service the servants the teachings of the Christian faith, graciously purify them by the working of this sacrifice through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as true man, he wept at Lazarus, his friend, and as eternal God, he raised him from the tomb. Just as taking pity on the human race, he leads us by sacred mysteries to new life. Through him, the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all that you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, you give life to all things and make them holy. You never cease to gather a people to yourself from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we brought you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. On the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave it to his friends, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the offering of your church, and graciously recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son may be filled with his Holy Spirit and become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an offering to you, so that we may obtain the inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and martyrs, with St. James, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, your servant Francis, our Pope, Jerome, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you've gathered before you. In your compassion, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the whole world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you by their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There, we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Pray now to God our Father in the words that Jesus our Lord gave us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
With your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only say the word, and my soul shall be. Thank you.
Those taking communion to our brothers and sisters at home are invited. Lord, we praise and thank you for this opportunity of sharing the word of the Eucharist with our brothers and sisters. May we continue to be with them on this Lenten journey as we look forward to the most sacred time of the year. We make these prayers of Christ our Lord. Amen.
This morning, the Knights of Columbus are serving their St. Patrick's Day breakfast, complete with green pancakes, sausage, and Irish coffee. Bring your appetite and join them after Mass. Blood pressure screening is available in the Great Room after Masses today. Save your aluminum cans, as the trailer will be back after Easter on April 9th and 10th. Tonight, after the Mass, join us at the Mission. Oops. Sorry, that was last night. See the bulletin website and Facebook for more information about activities here at St. James. Thank you.
A happy St. Patrick's Day to all the Hibernians who are here. Some of them are wearing green, others aren't. I hope nobody's wearing orange. That would be Northern Ireland. Let's rise now for our final prayer. Let us pray. We pray, Almighty God, that we may always be counted among the members of Christ, in whose body and blood we have communion, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Let's bow our heads now and pray for God's blessing. Bless the Lord your people who long for the gift of your mercy. Grant that what at your prompting we desire, we may receive by your generous gift through Christ our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass is now ended. Let us go in peace to love and to serve.
And as we go forth, let us sing, Lord, Let Me Walk, found on page 21.